thank you for joining on this rainy evening in Ankara. It's really nice to see people gathering around after the tragic events that we have all experienced here. And I'm Leonidas Karagassanis, the Assistant Director of the British Institute of Ankara. Let me start with introducing our speaker today, Katerina Dalacoura, who is an Associate Professor in International Relations at the London School of Economics and Political Science, LSE, and currently a British Academy mid-career fellow. She's the author of Islamist Terrorism and Democracy in the Middle East, which, while published back in 2011, resonates with questions that are very, very vibrant and pressing today, unfortunately. Katerina's research has been widely published on top-ranked journals and edited volumes, shedding light on different aspects of sociopolitical life in the entire Middle East. Examining many of the developments taking place in recent years, among them the Arab Spring in Egypt and the rise and fall of the Muslim Brotherhood, the role of religion in recent and historical conflicts, the role of gender and sexuality in shaping identities in the region. Human rights, democracy, and democracy promotion in the Middle East hold a nodal point in her interests, and among them, significant contributions that we find late in 2015 co-edited working paper at LSE on the state of democracy in Turkey, institutions, society, and foreign relations. So her talk today touches upon another field of her interests, which focuses on the role of culture and representations of culture and discourse of international relations theory produced in Turkey. A very interesting theme, standing at the intersection between disciplines like history, intellectual history, sociology of science, in this case of international relations as a scientific field, as well as international relations theory itself. It is part of a large project which is funded by the British Academy, if I'm not
Actually, no. It's just the 1 year.
It's the 1 year?
Yeah.
Okay. And we are really happy to have as a discussant here today, İlker, Aytürk, Assistant Professor at the Department of Political Science at Bilkent University, working there since 2004, if I'm not mistaken. And I'm happy to say that this is a kind of a perfect match today, because İlker is working in a department which IR has a strong influence, but in fact is a historian working on intellectual history and examining the role of discourse and language in shaping ideologies from Kemalism to Zionism to nationalism. Furthermore, he has also extensively published in international and Turkish academic journals on those above themes, with a specific expertise and interest in the intellectual development in early Republican Turkey. So, 45 to 50 minutes for your presentation, and then 10-15 minutes for the comment by İlker, and then we'll have an open Q&A session.
Okay, thank you so much. I was going to introduce a bit about my research interest, but you've done it. So I think hopefully you can see the connections where this project has come from, long-standing interest in human rights and international relations. Also, I've taught for a number of years a course called the International Politics of Religion and Culture. And the project on Turkey actually brings together these very different areas on which I have concentrated in the past few years. The question is a seemingly very simple, but of course deceptively simple one, that I wanted to address in this project. How do people, and I'll come to what I mean by people, in Turkey, think about culture and civilization within a global context? And in particular, I was curious, and I am curious to see if there are any new ideas about the big issues that go beyond the categories of East and West, Islam and secularism, these categories that seem to have become so solidified and to have captured in a bad way so much of our current discourse. Now, more specifically within international relations, which is my discipline, there has been much discussion in recent years of decentering moving away from the Anglo-Saxon core of the discipline and opening it up to non-Western other ideas and perspectives. Now, this has sometimes led to a crude cultural essentialism, the result, I think, of a dramatic swing of the pendulum, so to speak, from materialist to culturalist explanations. I think a more sophisticated debate within international relations is taking place under the influence of post-colonialism and also the English school and, more broadly, constructivism. It seemed to me, from within this world of international relations and from within these concerns of the discipline, that a way forward would be to do some proper empirical investigation. Now, Turkey, the focus of this investigation, is of course a great case for studying conceptions of culture and civilization because of its lengthy, complex, and tumultuous relationship with Europe, the West, and modernity. Its being a successor state to a powerful empire, never colonized, with a robust and long-standing tradition of state, adds to the complexity of the relationship. For some, of course, Turkey is part of the West, and every time I associate Turkey with non-West, I cringe a little bit internally. For others, it is a quintessential torn country, in Samuel Huntington's infamous formulation. Now, there is no doubt that on one level, and from one perspective, and that's something I'll return to at the end, Turkish society is dominated by the categories of East and West, Islam and secularism, rigidly conceived. Now, especially in the very bitterly divided political period which Turkey is currently experiencing, this is definitely, I think, the case. But what the project hopes to do, and I'm still hopeful that it will do, is to find ways to at least investigate what lies beneath these simple and simplistic categories of East, West, Islam, and secularism, and hopefully go beyond these categories. Now, to carry out the investigation in this project, I'm focusing on a number of contemporary intellectuals and their ideas, situating them within Turkey's intellectual history. So what I'm going to do in the first part of the lecture is to give this intellectual history, but please note that this is not just history, but it provides, I think, in my mind at least, the conceptual framework without which we cannot really understand the contemporary debates. Now, from the late 18th century, due to trade and geopolitical pressures, including being pulled into the balance of power system, the Ottoman Empire became increasingly drawn into Europe. Now, of course, the empire was geographically in Europe, as the real homeland of many Turks was the Ottoman Balkans. We had a discussion about that just now, not Anatolia. As these lands were lost in the course of the 19th century, the importance of the Arab Middle East increased in relation to the core of the empire. Now, it is conventionally argued that these processes were accelerated in the case of the Ottoman Empire in the 19th century, and that this was done under duress because of a sense of decline. When I say these processes, I mean the process of change and reform. What is more, reforms with a view to competing with Europe were increasingly being undertaken. Recent scholarship has moved away from the idea that the late Ottomans were passive recipients of European impositions and has gone in the direction of reasserting Ottoman agency. I think this is an important correction. It is confirmed when we observe the growing grip of the very idea of reform itself among the Ottoman ruling elites, which is something that occurs throughout Europe, and of course it occurs also in Turkey. The belief that reform was possible and that the empire could be improved and strengthened through the actions of individuals revolutionized Ottoman worldviews and perceptions about the cosmos, about history, politics, and the relationship between human beings and God. Now, linked to the idea of reform and underpinning the intellectual trends that emerged was the gradual objectification of Islam. Until the 19th century, reference to Islam as an identifiable set of traditions was almost non-existent. From then onwards, of course, this is a gradual process, Islam, just as religion and religions generally, becomes something out there to be thought about, to be shaped, manipulated by the subject, by the person. The individual is no longer the vehicle of cosmic forces. Instead, he or she can think about and shape religion, which in some cases turns into a blueprint for the ideal society. And if we fast forward to the current situation, the slogan, the Islamist slogan, Islam is the solution, is, I think, a continuation, a result of this change. This is very much the age of ideology in Europe and elsewhere, and I think the empire falls within that conceptual transformation. Another point is that a similar development occurred with regards to the idea of civilization. The content of civilizations, like religions, of course, existed before the 19th century. No one is saying that they did not. But what is new, and I think quintessentially modern as a development, is that from that moment, the human being can take a distance from, think about, identify, and even shape civilization. During the period of Abdul Hamid, we observe in the Ottoman Empire, in the Arab lands, in South Asia, and in Russia, the emergence of the idea of the Islamic world. Many authors have traced how travel and the spread of the printing press, travelogues, new technologies created and reinforced the notion that there is such a unified community that is called the Islamic world. With, of course, in our case, the Ottoman Empire at its heart, at its core. Now, this became linked to the idea of an Islamic civilization. And that Islamic civilization began to be conceived as being in contradistinction to European civilization, but also civilization more generally as a kind of universal concept. Now, the word civilization enters the Ottoman lexicon in the 19th century, but it only appeared in France in the middle of the 18th century. So civilization was a relatively recent concept in Europe as well. In the Ottoman setting, it was used as such, civilisation, but then, of course, it was translated into its modern sort of form, medeniyet. The same etymology being with civilization and medeniyet, of course, the city. It replaced the word umran, which was Ibn Khaldun's term, and it contained within it, as the word does in English, the meanings of urbanity and civility. For the Ottoman cultivated man, civilization was a contest between urbanization and nomadism. It was not about religion as such, but it was about culture and manners. So we see, for instance, reference to the Maronites and the Druze of Mount Lebanon, to the Albanian highlanders, to the Arab Bedouin, to the Yemenis, as savages who were looked down upon, irrespective of whether they were Christians or Muslims or whatever else. However, at the same time as these meanings of urbanity and civility and manners and all that's associated with it, of course, medeniyet in the course of the 19th century also begins to refer to a collectivity, a collective identity, in the sense that I outlined Islamic, European, or then, of course, becomes something else when it refers to the universal setting. Now, we should not assume, and again, the current literature talks a lot about that, that categories such as secularism were already dominant in the 19th century. I think we cannot, as good social scientists and historians, draw a straight line backwards from our categories of today necessarily to that period of the late 19th century. The intellectuals of the period, for instance, the young Ottomans of the 1870s and later, thought not necessarily in terms of secular versus religious, but in terms of modernity and Islam, as opposed to modernity versus Islam. So their wish and their desire was to create a new Ottoman culture that would be modern without being westernized. Now, this changes with the Young Turks, of course. And we all know, I mean, I don't need to tell you very much about the Young Turks in this. Of course, you're very familiar with all these debates. But the Young Turks, of course, very briefly represent a step away from the Young Ottoman position, collectively understood, towards positivism and scientific materialism. So by the time of the dissolution of the empire and the arrival of the republic, I think that the categories of East and West, modernity, Islam, and European versus Islamic civilizations, as well as the idea of a universal civilization, are becoming increasingly set in meanings that we currently would be able to recognize, even though the content of these categories was evaluated differently depending on where you stood politically, good or bad. So there was that contestation in terms which are very different from what is happening nowadays. But the categories, I think, become recognizable by the point at which the Republic is set up. The dominant position post-1923, represented, epitomized, of course, by Atatürk and his cohort, is that civilization is one, it is universal, and it is identified with Europe or the West, even though this also comes alongside a very strong nationalist ideology, Turkish nationalist ideology, which was opposed to political domination from the West. Being civilized meant being scientific and being positivist. Culture was subsumed under civilization, and Kemalism, of course, aimed to transform both high Islamic civilization and low, in inverted commas, popular culture. So in an interesting inversion, the Kemalist universalist conception of civilization and the rather uniform idea of culture that came with it replaced the cosmopolitanism of the Ottoman Empire. This is not a word I will explore, but we can talk about the difference in the Q&A later. But be that as it may, East and West had by that time become irrevocable enemies, locked in perennial opposition, something which is, I think, with us still today. With the adoption of secularism as a key tenet of the Republic, the link between Islam and the state was broken, or at least massively reconstituted. Islamic thought became marginalized. The ulama, the official class of religious functionaries, were to all intents and purposes eliminated, and the production of official religious discourse subordinated to the state through the Diyanet. More broadly, whereas until the late Ottoman period, most intellectuals were bureaucrats or lived on some stipend from the state, now the intellectuals gradually become a separate class of people. Within that new category or class of people, Islamist intellectuals are few and far between in the early Republican period, and they are pushed to the sidelines. So the major debates, as you all know, in the first decades of the Republic occur within the framework of secularism and politically in the framework of the right versus the left. However, the absence of intellectuals did not mean that Islam or Islamic thought suddenly disappeared. The tariqats, the jamaats, had spread, of course, and had become very powerful through the 19th century, and they continue to be important, providing a link between elite civilization and popular culture, even though they were officially banned. The Naqshbandi and Nurji movements in particular permeated social life and also penetrated political life, connecting the urban and the rural worlds. Now, their approach to Islam is very, very much contested and disputed. For some, they symbolize backwardness and obscurantism. For others, they brought Islam in line with modernity. And it's interesting for me as an outsider to actually capture in the different literatures how profoundly different these evaluations of a figure like Said Nursi could be. It's really quite extraordinary. Now, the religious orders were also linked to some of the individual thinkers whose work I examined for the project. Now, these individuals produced their own works, their oeuvre, to use the right French word, I think. But many of them also have an important background or foundation in these religious orders. From 1950 onwards, with the introduction of multi-partyism in Turkey, they are also linked to political parties of either right-wing conservative or outright Islamist persuasion. Needless to say, the influence of these intellectuals has been steadily increasing since the near total eclipse around the establishment of the Republic in 23. Now, a first generation of Islamist intellectuals emerges in the 30s and 40s. It is difficult to generalize about these people. For example, a fascinating and somewhat unusual figure is Cemil Meriç, whose ideas had similarities with contemporary thinkers in Japan and in Iran as well. Influenced by Marxism, Meriç questioned the categories of East and West. He argued that the people must not be deprived of memory and culture, as the Kemalist reforms had attempted to do. Though he also noted that music was the one area of culture that had been at least changed by these reforms. Necip Fazıl Kısakürek, Nurettin Topçu, Sezai Karakoç saw Islam as an ideology and as having its own civilization as well as being strictly a religion. They argued, and particularly Kısakürek, as you all know, I'm sure was the major figure here, that Islam is a civilization, but in Turkey it's culturally specific. Now, Kısakürek has influenced the President of the Republic, by his own admission, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. And it is interesting to go through the often very contradictory ideas that he had to present about his vision. He was a very prolific and active individual. his totalistic, even fascistic worldview, which called for Turkey to be cleansed of Jews and dönme, connected this Islamic civilization, as he saw it, to the Great East, with Turkey at its core. The Ottoman Empire constituted the essence of this civilization. And he saw nationalism, Kisakürek that is, as being in the service of Islam, not vice versa. Now there's clearly a link between the thought of Kisakürek and others of his generation with the totalitarian ideologies of the 1930s. Furthermore, more than Kisakürek and others like him care to admit, their thought was shaped by their secular education within the Republic and the intellectual production of Europe with which they constantly engaged and with which they were very familiar. The explosion of the media in the 50s and 60s meant that the message of these intellectuals reached a wider public, even though we have to remember that in those decades, culture and the arts, literature in particular, with the exception of music again, is dominated by Marxist thinkers and artists and other creators. Leftist, I would say, not necessarily Marxist, perhaps is an exaggeration. Now, the 1970s witnessed the emergence of a new Islamist discourse linked to Necmettin Erbakan's Milli Görüş movement. This was a political movement which associated Islam and the Turkish nation more closely. For Erbakan, Turkey is the cultural center of Islamic civilization in Europe. For that outlook, for his outlook, the West's success was based on technology, and economic development required religious faith, not a cultural transformation. So he was, as we were saying this morning, he was one of those who thought that you could isolate elements of the West and borrow some parts of it, of that civilization, not the whole thing. This is has a long tradition in Islamic thought. After 1980, a new generation of Islamic intellectuals arrives at the scene. These years witness an enormous growth of Islamic currents, trends, and activities, and also saw identity politics replacing the left-right divisions which had been dominant until then. The new Islamic or new Muslim intellectual was a product, again, of the 1950 Republican education system, post-1950 Republic education system. He, or sometimes we can say she here, spoke Western languages and was conversant with European philosophy. He or she was not necessarily in touch with ordinary people or the local imam or hodja. In sociological and cultural terms, he or she was perhaps closer to the secular intellectuals who were their interlocutors, who were their opponents intellectually in some ways. People such as Rasim Özdenören, Ali Bulaç, İsmet Özel questioned both the glorification of the Ottoman past and the Kemalist project of civilization. They rebelled against science, technology, democracy, and civilization. Their proposed answer was very different from the previous Islamist generation's answer. It was, look to the Quran and the Hadith, look at the basics, the fundamentals of the religion, in order to find the solutions and the answers. Ali Bulaç, at least in his early 1980s sort of writings, has been described as a cultural Islamist in that he declared that the idea of an Islamic state had failed because, politicization threatens Islam with materialization and secularization. He argued that the modern state is inherently totalitarian because it legislates and regulates everyone in all aspects of life. Now, I think it's very interesting to note again how this discourse runs parallel to discourses in the West, which are postmodernist discourses, and they have a resonance with this questioning of science, technology, development, the whole shebang of self-criticism that comes along in that period in the West, I think has interesting echoes to with this group of thinkers. They also have, this group of thinkers, similarities to the Islamist discourses emerging in the Middle East and the wider Islamic world. So what we see is Turkey, of course, being its own world, its own case, but having interesting similarities and differences with both the West and the Islamic world more widely. Now, with the 90s, we can observe yet another fascinating shift in this story. With an important strand in the Islamist current becoming open to the West, and specifically the EU, we see a turnaround here in assertions that Turkey's accession to the European Union would not symbolize a civilizational shift. So this is very different to what someone like Erbakan, of course, would say. This major transformation was underpinned by, of course, as we all know, a political sea change in Turkey, with a shift in terms of the creation of the AKP towards the political center, away from the welfare party, and also a shift towards greater openness and embracing of neoliberal economics, which comes also with the arrival of the AKP. But my project is, I mean, I'm trying to limit it to looking at the ideas a little bit in the abstract, because if I attempt to associate it and to link it with all the important political, economic, and social developments in the country, I will never end. I mean, it will become, or end, it will become a different project, not as it was conceived in the beginning. Now, within that context, as I've described it, there has been a proliferation of Islamist strands or lines of thought with different approaches towards the big questions of culture and civilization. But I will concentrate on two opposing views within this set of ideas. Now, one strand, as I suggested already just before, rejects the very idea of civilization. İsmet Özel argues that the very term and concept of civilization must be rejected. He has picked up, rightly, I think, in my view, that civilization implies man-made institutions. He challenges the idea that an Islamic state and law must be the aim of committed Muslims, and argues that they would prove fatal to truth and justice. Islam is not a civilization. This is, he says, a Western Orientalist position, though it has the potential to become one, and a civilization free of the class differentiation and exploitation that associates such a thing in the West. Originally a leftist, Özel sees civilization as understood in this sort of pejorative sense, as implying class division and subjection to materialism. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, that his accusations that the AKP has betrayed the Islamist cause is one reason why he's relatively marginalized in the current scene. I may be wrong here, I'm not sure, but that's the sense I have got. Now, opposed to that strand of thought is the discourse on civilization presented by Ahmet Davutoğlu. For Davutoğlu, Turkey is at the center of an Islamic civilization which offers an alternative to Western civilization. Now, there is a debate in the literature on whether at the core of Davutoğlu's worldview lies Islam or a neo-Ottoman perspective. My sense is that he sees the two as interdependent, much, of course, to the dismay of Islamists who want to return to the first early years of Islam as the ideal time of Islam. Davutoğlu not only sees Western and Islamic civilizations as competing, but he sees the latter as superior, more humane, less atomistic, less materialistic. In his academic books on the subject, and I haven't been able to follow, of course, his, I'm sure, massive number of statements, he sees, I've just read the three academic books he's written on the subject and a few articles. He sees Turkey as active in all regions that surround it, including the Balkans, the Caucasus, the Middle East, as well as belonging to Europe, if Europe would accept it. He argues against Fukuyama and also against Huntington, and he does not see relations between Western and Islamic civilizations as necessarily conflictual. He criticizes Huntington's view of Turkey as a torn country, but only to say that it would not be torn if it followed its own true civilizational destiny. So you can see where it is he's coming from. For supporters of Davutoglu's ideas, Turkey has a historic mission and can be integrated with both East and West. For critics of Davutoglu, his vision is Islamic and it essentializes East and West. My view is that, having read what he's written, particularly in his first two books, not the strategic depth, that he does indeed see East and West as essentially different. I think he says it in so many words, of course, through the academic analysis. And the East as superior, as I said. But he does not necessarily think that this leads to conflict. And this is the difference, I think, from someone like Huntington, who would indeed see it as inevitable that this conflict would arise. Now, linked to Davutoğlu, there are a host of other intellectuals, all writing about civilization and culture. And they share with him, I think, the idea of difference, though not necessarily of a clash, and the sense of an Islamic and Ottoman civilization having superior values. However, all of these different thinkers have sort of their own exposition ideas about the different aspects, the different roles that the different actors would play and how they come about. For instance, Ibrahim Kalin, who, as we know, is, of course, the AKP spokesman at the moment, in his book on East-West, he writes that Islam is a neutral religion and does not impose a particular type of civilizational identity. So that's why it has coexisted through history with different civilizational settings. So this is a different take on the subject compared to Davutoğlu. Now, there is, of course, a whole school of thought in Turkey today associated with Fethullah Gülen, whom, this is not a cop-out, I have no problem, I have not had time to explore as yet, so I will not talk about Gülen's thought. But what I think is interesting about Gulen is that, of course, he comes at, as the product of this very, I think particularly Turkish tradition of we can call it the Nurcu tradition. And as I said earlier, this tradition is hugely contested when it comes to the relationship it has with modernity. So I think this is kind of this is going to be very tricky ground. Now, is there a non-Islamic centered counter-narrative to the Islamist discourses in Turkey at the moment? Does there exist a secular, post-Kemalist universalism, for instance, which poses itself against the Islamic and neo-Ottoman-centered views which have dominated this debate? There is certainly, I think, a search in Turkey, as of course in other parts of the world, for a new formula, a rigorous critique of the Enlightenment project without surrendering its liberating and humanist principles. So that search, I think, is still ongoing in this country, as in many other parts of the world. However, I have not found major secular thinkers tackling those big issues in ways similarly to the Islamists, as I have said. And of course, one reason why I am in Turkey and presenting my ideas to audiences like you is for me to get suggestions from you and to hear if there are people that I have missed or I should be looking at in the context of this particular project. Now, you will have noticed that I'm using the terms Islamist and secularist, which are the ones in starting the project I wanted to overcome. And sadly, I'm feeling that it is not possible at this stage to overcome them, for the reasons that, of course, politically Turkey is so divided, and also the politics is seeping into, it's sort of intimately connected to the intellectual discourse. Now, if anything, the research, the way the project is going, or my search, if you want to call it that, is leading me to two areas which lie, strictly speaking, outside what I was meant to be doing in the beginning. One area is historiography, and the other area is literature. Let me start with the first. I want to mention a particular historian of Islamist thought whose ideas potentially could be instructive for the search, for the research that I'm doing, and that is İsmail Kara. In some of his works, Kara argues, because of course he covers in his many books a whole host of issues, but in some of what he has written, he argues that the introduction of the ideas of progress and civilization in the 19th century shaped the historiography of Islam and the content of Islamic thought in a particular way, and I think he would say in a pernicious way. He argues that Muslim thinkers were very quick to interpret political and military defeats of Muslim-majority societies as cultural, social, and institutional defeats for Islam. They lamented past glories, and this led to a break with history and a fixation on an idealized golden era of Islam, the time of the Prophet and the rightly guided caliphs. Islam, so the argument went, included all the virtues of progress, science, and civilization, which it gave to the West. But the difference here, and this is what Kara analyzes, exposes in his writings, is that before those ideas took hold, Islamic scholars saw history as the history of humanity, starting with Adam and Eve, but in that sort of break that the 19th century constituted, actual history was transformed through a lens of the Golden Age. From that point onwards, Kara says, and this is a problem, history was seen as a burden, not as a treasure. And this has created a lot of problems when it comes to Islamist thinking later on. I would suggest, sort of taking Kara's views a step further, that reconnecting with history and moving away from the fixation with an ideal time, which, by the way, is common in many other parts of the world in the 19th century. We see it in Romanticism, we see it in the growth of nationalism, for instance, Greek nationalism, the fixation on the ideal past, that moving away from that will create a new universalism. That's my sort of exposition, my further taking Kara's thinking further. Now, this rethinking would not be a reassertion of the Western / European-centered historical writing of Ahmed Cevdet, for instance, but a reclaiming of a balanced view that attributes agency to both sides, European-Western and Ottoman-Turkish. Now, literature also, this is with regards to historiography, and I still have doubts that I understand the word historiography correctly, but we can discuss that perhaps later. With regards to literature, it also holds promise, I think, in other ways, different from what historiography does. Turkey has a long and vibrant literary tradition, as we all know. But surveys of Turkish literature are plagued by the Orientalist-nationalist binary. Both perspectives, of course, being in some ways ahistorical. But there are many, or increasingly more hopeful views or readings of literary modernity in Turkey, in which these categories are recast in a different way. Now, I have, as an outsider, a particular view of, maybe it's the benefit of outsiders, I have a view of Turkey as being an extremely rich, dense, complicated, big, and uncategorizable, if this is a word, society. And I think it is very difficult for us as social scientists in particular, or people in the humanities, to, I think it's really difficult for all of us to see Turkey as being going, all of it, one way or another way. And I think a lot of the problem of the current discourse, the popular discourse, is that it tends to simplify the complexity and especially the relationship that the country has to modernity, which is, as I said, so rich and so dense. I don't have the research for this. I wish I had another life and I could do it, but I don't. But it's really fascinating to see how different, for instance, opinion polls and surveys reflect different aspects of groups of people and which ways they're going. So it's impossible to call it a uniform entity. Now, what happens in the literary works is that they pick up on this complexity, I think, in ways that it is impossible, perhaps, for social scientists and sociologists in particular to do. And this is why I think there is more about the richness of the country in literature, perhaps, and a potential for the breaking down of the categories that we all seem to struggle with in politics and social theory. Now, I have 5 minutes, perfect. Okay, this is my conclusion. I want to end by emphasizing something that I hope has become apparent. I've also emphasized it, sort of mentioned it myself, but hopefully it's come out of what I've said, which is that the debate on culture and civilization since the 19th century are firmly embedded within a global, first European, then Western and global context. The global marketplace of ideas. They are defined, the terms themselves, by the conceptual framework of modernity, and I think it would have been impossible to think about them as we do now, funnily enough, without the conceptual transformation of the 19th century. Even though these ideas claim to be about trans-historical realities, in fact, we have to recognize that they are of relatively recent origin. They are not, in fact, sort of harking back to time immemorial. And it's interesting, I think, to recognize that this is something that happens in Europe as well as in Turkey. Europe undergoes the same conceptual transformation in the 19th century, which is the century that, in fact, shapes us until today in a variety of ways. Now, the influence of the Romantic movement, as I said, and the growth of nationalism in the context of ideology more broadly also has interesting parallels with what's going on in the late Ottoman and early Republican periods. The similarities to totalitarian ideologies in the 30s, the reaction to modernity and modernization theory in the 80s, and so on, also have interesting parallels. The rise of identity and culturalist politics, culturalism is a different thing from culture, from the 1970s onwards, is a worldwide phenomenon. We can see it across the world, in countries as different, of course, as India, and in other ways, of course, in other parts of the world. And there are similarities between Turkish thought and other societies, perhaps in the same historical position, such as Iran and Japan. There's a little sort of literature all of its own on these comparisons, which I haven't had time to look at yet, but it indicates something, I think, very interesting. All the Islamist intellectuals I have studied or begun to study in for this project, similarly to their secular counterparts, are lodged in conversation with European, Western, and global thinkers, and they have been formed in the current period in a secular and Western school system in Republican Turkey. This is a sociological fact. When they refer to Islamist thought, many of these thinkers actually do so through Western Orientalists, as they used to be called, or Islamist thinkers, European and Western, more generally, academic texts. And they operate, of course, as I mentioned, in ways and with categories that are universal. Whatever Ismet-Özel wishes for, I think that the water, as we say in England, has gone irrevocably, I'm mixing my metaphors, under the bridge. And it is impossible to go back to a situation where we had different categories of mind. That's the wish for him, but it is actually not a feasible thing. It's a chimera. To try to impose it, as he recognizes, would be attended by disastrous political consequences. And I think the same applies to Davutoglu, who fails to recognize that his thought about Islam shares Western characteristics and frameworks. I mean, he's not shy of quoting Western thinkers, and if you look at his academic books, he refers to Western and Islamic thinkers. But I think, that's my reading of the books, he doesn't actually recognize that his own thought is shaped by the Western thinkers that he criticizes. And that, I think, is an important point to be made with regards to him. It's a different thing from Özel, but I think there are problems there. The questions we tend to ask about the plurality of civilizations, are they different? How are they different? In what ways are they different between each other? Somehow obscure the degree to which I think we share common categories and concepts, as I've said. However, I want to emphasize, and you know, I think I have to, as an international relations person coming from that discipline, that the sharing of concepts and categories doesn't mean that conflict is lessened. On the contrary, as we know, civil war is the most vicious of all wars. Now, returning to the big questions about modernity within the context of IR, I think, the project or the conclusions that I draw from all of this subverts the idea of multiple modernities in favor of greater commonality between societies. I don't want to push this too far, because I think if we just simply assert, we're all modern, then the word loses its meaning. So I think if we talk about the commonality that we share as modern societies, we have to specify exactly what we mean by that if it is to be an interesting assertion and not just a cultural relativist or a relativist full stop assertion. I see, and this is my very final point, that the problem with East-West categories is that they obstruct our search for answers to the truly important question, which is the question I outlined before: how to preserve the liberating and humanist aspects of Enlightenment thought, given all the problems that had been historically associated with that thought. I personally think, and the project leads me to that, but maybe I have led it to that. I mean, we all know objectivity is a funny thing when it comes to social science. But I see that the East-West binary is in fact a diversion. It stops us from seeing the real dividing line, and the real dividing line is between liberal and non-liberal thinkers, liberal and non-liberal strands of thought, not between East and West. And I think putting the dividing line there actually takes us forward. Okay. Thank you.
Hello, good evening. Can you all hear me? Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Katerina and Leo, for inviting me this evening to act as discussant. And thank you all for showing up on a rainy Ankara evening. It's very brave of you to show up, actually, after all these bombings. This is a project that I find very interesting.
Thank you.
I have a couple of comments, and I hope my comments will help you, however little, in what you will do after this talk. Now, let me begin. You see, I mean, all these notes, I have a lot of notes. I had the privilege of reading the text before I came here. So I have a couple of responses, and these are a little disconnected from one another and maybe a little disorganized for you. But I'll try to keep them as short as possible to make time for the Q&A. Let me begin with the Kemalists and their universalism. You argued, and rightly argued, that Kemalists believed in one civilization and the supremacy of the Western set of values. That's true, but I think they were not free in their choice. I think they were pushed into a corner to accept this fact. Let's remember that the Kemalist elites were survivors from the terrible last decade of the Ottoman Empire, right? Which is a long decade, which runs from 1911 to 1922, starting with the war over Tripoli, then the two Balkan wars, then the Great War, the First World War, then what Turks call their War of Independence. And at the end, what they had was a shadow of their former self, right? With a much shrunken territory, population, devastated country. They survived, and this was an elite which was determined not to make this happen again. Right? They were ready to go at great lengths to prevent another disaster like this. And they were born into an international society which was very different from what we have today. Today we are operating in an international society which is, what, like 200 plus states, right? At the time it was probably less than 50.
Yes.
Today nation states are, on legal terms, all on an equal footing, right? State sovereignty is so important today that even humanitarian intervention becomes a problem. At the time, they had no such problems, right? It was a very hierarchical international society. There were great powers which imposed their will on the weaker powers. And of course, there was something, this mission civilisatrice, right? The Western values were superior. Now, the Kemalist elites probably internalized all this. And their response, their universalism, was, I would say, a survival tactic. Right? They thought that if there is the civilization out there, it's the enemy, and you would survive only by joining it. So all these reforms of the early republic, right? Changing one's alphabet, numerals, wearing a hat, converting Hagia Sophia into a museum. All these, what I call image politics, were actually, I mean, partly, not actually, but partly, a response to this international environment. They were securitizing the image, I would say. To look more Western was one of the ways to avoid future entanglement in an international conflict, right? They wanted to look like others. They want to join the superior civilization so that they would not become victims of another aggression in the future. I'm sure you're familiar with Ayşe Zarakol's book on how Turks, the Japanese, and the Russians dealt with defeat in the hands of Western powers. I think she is making similar arguments there. So that was my first comment. Secondly, I'm glad you have picked these Islamic intellectuals. However, I think naming them is very difficult. You want to call them Islamic scholars or Islamic-leaning scholars. Some of them were not necessarily very Islamic. It was a mix of Islam and nationalism. At the time, they were not called Islamists, right? In the 50s, 60s, and 70s, that was like a taboo word. They went by other names. They were called Mukaddesatçılar, for example. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm glad you are working on these people, because so far, since the 1980s, the Turkish academia has spent all its mental energy on coming to terms with the Unionists and the Kemalists, right? We are dealing with for the last three decades, and I think this is an act of catharsis, right? Coming to terms. We believe that all our present problems have been created from basically 1910s to 1950s. So we have to come to terms with this period so that we can find solutions to our current issues. So what I call the post-Kemalists have been dealing with this period, exclusively. And I'm a little bit bored with that now. I mean, I think currently we have other problems, and these current problems do not necessarily have their roots in the early Republican period or with the Unionists. So it might be time to move on from this intellectual myopia, right? And I call this myopia because we know far more about the Unionists and the early Republican period compared to the very little that we know about the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. Mm-hmm. at whatever is actually close to us, we know much less about that. So we need to change that, I think. My current research is about anti-Semitism in radical right-wing circles during or from 1940s to 1980s, and I came across the same problem. There is very little secondary material, right? There has been very little analytical work done on this period and on these people. And this is because of the post-Kemalist emphasis on the earlier periods. So we know very little about the environments that gave birth to these intellectuals that you're studying. And that's the Cold War environment. Right? Cold War is becoming a very important topic in all NATO countries today. This construction of a national security state, how elites interacted with this national security state. I think that's the future frontier of social science and humanities in Turkey as well. We are at the beginnings of that. So the environment is very important because the leading figures in AKP today, policymakers and ideologues, the Islamic intellectuals that you're talking about, most of them are in their late 50s and sometimes to their late 60s. They were born exactly into that environment. It shaped their worldview, and we need to study that in its context. Secondly, we know very little about the ideologues themselves. I think we still lack good academic scholarly biographies of people like Kısakürek, Özel, Sezai Karakoç, and all others. There is very little secondary work done on these people. And of course, we know also very little about the current policymakers. I mean, you mentioned Davutoğlu, that's a very good point. Many people endorsed him as Turkey's greatest ever foreign minister when he came to power. In when was that? 2011? I can't remember that.
Which
exactly.
Yeah.
Well, he first acted as advisor, and then as foreign minister, and then as prime minister. When people endorsed him, I was asking people at the time, well, have you read his work? Some people had read chapters or introduction from his famous book, but nothing else. I haven't met many people who read the entire book. So if you read what he wrote in the 1990s, for example, I'm sure you did, it gives you a clue about his worldview. That's very different from what people thought he was. So we need to recognize these figures. We study them we need to study them in detail. I think it would help you a lot if you do a prosopographic research about these people, like Zürher did for the Kemalist elite, right? You would paint a group portrait of Islamic intellectuals in Turkey by first forming a pool of such names, and then you just have a set of questions to ask, right? Like age group, gender, geographical origins, social class background, ethnicity maybe, right? And then you might have a very interesting picture at the end. Then another comment about the Islamists in the 1980s. You mentioned the emergence of the Islamic intellectuals as a major intellectual group in the 80s. Well, of course, their sudden visibility was not their own making, right? They were pushed under the limelight by what we today call the liberal left. The liberal left, the term liberal left is very hard to define today because too many people seem to belong to that category and they have different opinions. But as an umbrella term, I'm talking about people who were diehard socialists in the 60s and 70s, and for all kinds of reasons they became disillusioned with socialism after the coup in 1980. Some of them now became liberals and / leftists. But they still had a problem. They had no buyers for their socialism among the public, and now they similarly had no buyers for their liberalism, their liberal left views in the greater Turkish public. They couldn't appeal to the masses, right? They were, and I think they felt like rootless intellectuals who did not belong to the country. That's when they discovered the natives, right? And when I, what I mean by the natives is the Islamists, right? If you read people who wrote in Birikim in the 80s and 90s, if you read people who published and who supervised publications in İletişim Group, for example, you will find many such names. Who thought this new rising generation of Islamic intellectuals might actually be their anchor in Turkey? So they opened up this all these liberal left publications to them, recognized them recognized them for the first time as public intellectuals, respected figures with whom you can meet and interact on an equal footing. That's how Ali Bulaçbaşı, for example, was discovered, right? And secondly, there's also the impact of this education, and you mentioned that as well. That's a very good point. I think it has two legs. On the one hand, YÖK and the National Education Ministry in Turkey sent hordes of people abroad in the early 1990s, and many of them were picked. I mean, the people who were picking these candidates were usually right-wing ministers of education before the 28th of February. And these were mostly right-wingers, right-wing students who went usually to UK to get a PhD there. Oh. And they came back as people who received Western education, but who were still right-wingers and usually Islamists. And also in Turkey, this is the second leg, there was a parallel development. Many liberal left professors in elite universities in Turkey, like Boğaziçi, there were fewer at the time, Boğaziçi Middle East Technical University or Bilkent, they adopted Islamist students as future colleagues and collaborators against the Kemalist establishment. Many of them today have joined the ranks of AKP in their think tanks or elsewhere. Now, as a group, I find this group very interesting because they learned how to speak the language of social sciences. Right? They have complete mastery over the jargon. Right? They can quote Weber or Bourdieu or Habermas or Foucault. They are postmodernists suddenly. In terms of methodology, they're very weak. And that's intentional because they avoid applying what they learned to what I call a zone of immunity. For example, they're very fond of deconstructing the Kemalist modernity project, right? They use Foucault for that. They use all other kinds of Western scholars, this postmodern movement as well. But for example, they would never apply it to Islam. Right? They would never deconstruct Islam in that way. That's their zone of comfort. They feel at home there, so they're very selective in their choice of data and in the topics they study. And my last comment is going to be, we usually think of Kemalists and the Kemalist elites as intellectuals or as a political class, people who are cut off from the public, right? They're elites, they don't belong, they have brought an alien ideology and civilization and values to Turkey, so they are a people apart. Now, interestingly, I wouldn't push too hard for this, but my hunch is the Islamic intellectuals are also on the way to becoming cut off from the Muslim public. These other figures you're talking about, with the exception of Ahmet Davutoğlu, and there are special circumstances there, the other figures you're talking about, they have very little appeal among the Muslim masses in Turkey. They only speak to university people who have received a university education. The aspirants, so-called, right? Davutoğlu is a separate case because, of course, he wraps all his very essentialist views in a new Ottoman discourse, and that increases the appeal. Right? Suddenly, Turks feel like they belong to an empire again, which is about to conquer the former territories. So it gives them pride. It gives them a story. Right? That's the story the Islamists lacked in Turkey. Right? Kemalists had a story. They saved the country, and with that prestige, they ran the country for a very long time. But now the Islamists have finally a story there of their own. And they call, I would call it the new Ottoman story. It gives them something to be proud of. And Davutoğlu has been successful, or very visible, because he is the person who provides all this jargon and discourse. And but even then, he wouldn't compare to Erdogan, for example. And there we see this huge gap between the Islamic intellectuals and the Islamic or Islamist politicians. And in politics, it's a totally different ball game. I mean, just pay attention how they accuse Davutoğlu, right? They say he can't appeal to the people. Mm. He's not a good public speaker and all that. So let me stop there and take questions.
Can I just respond to the last point? Of course, I haven't gone deep enough in tracing the various intellectuals and their sociological standing. Mm-hmm. But I don't know if you, I'm sure you read it, that I said that even as this group was emerging in the 80s, it had more in common with their secular mm-hmm. counterparts sure. than with ordinary people. Now, that's not to say that they're not important, but I wonder if that is what you
exactly
if you meant that, yeah. that in terms of to whom the discourse appeals, how it is framed. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Interestingly, these intellectuals had perhaps a limited appeal. Of course, we have a continuing expansion of media, which probably means that someone like Ali Bulac or others, I mean, I sometimes look at the numbers of followers that some people have. I can't remember now who I'm referring to, and you go to Twitter and you see that this guy has 100,000 followers or something. I mean, the numbers are astonishing when it comes to some of these figures and their social media following mm-hmm. and appeal. What does this mean? Well, what can you say in Twitter? But still, you can influence with snapshots, I suppose, or people resonate. What you say resonates with what people think, possibly. That's the thing. Now, the thing is that there's a whole other area, and here the connections are not clear to me, between the world of the tariqat and the jamaat, which to me is an unknown, but I can sense that it's out there and it's important, and how it links up with all these individuals. That is something I think to be considered. Again, of course, it's a mistake to simplify and sort of say that all these groups or associations go in one particular direction or another. So I keep on hearing snippets of how complicated their internal politics are and how different they are with regards to their views and how even towards the AKP they are very conflicted sometimes. So it's not a very simple picture. But there may be a link through these associations between some of these figures and the wider public. Mm-hmm. Finally, what is the wider public in Turkey? I mean, we tend to generalize generalize about the people in Turkey, but can we generalize about the people in Turkey? Who are the people? I've traveled very little in the country, but I've been astonished at how different it is to what I imagined. So who are the people? I just don't know if we can just say, here are the people and here are the intellectuals. The categories are, I think, totally outdated, if they ever were suitable. But thank you very much for your comments.
So, shall
we
I take the questions?
We have 10 minutes for questions.
Oh, is that all?
Oh. Because it's already 8:30. Okay. Let's make it 15, okay. And we can continue with some wine and then questions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I wanted to ask about, well, you kind of left us with this binary of non-liberal, liberal.
Yes.
And I guess the other binary we have is this Islamist, Kemalist, / i.e. European, somehow synonymous trains of thought. But what about, and then when you were talking about the biographies of these people, I was thinking, well, these university days of the 1970s, the Turkish university was obviously a very fraught place. And the thing I think you left out, or you mentioned briefly, was the fact that radical left, the militant left and militant Marxism, what is the relationship with this third party? Now, obviously, that's changed a lot since that period when it had a big kind of campus, militant campus presence. But it's also now still existing, and it's still another, you have an alternative universalism there that's plugged into, like you were saying, some of these also plugged into some postmodern thinkers, like supposedly Benedict Anderson was very influential on Öcalan since he's been in Imrala. Plugged into some of these critiques of the Enlightenment critiques that have come about. And now is functioning, I suppose they're no longer in dialogue, the Islamists and these radical leftists. It's more something like a denial of their, mutual humanity or something going along those lines. But can you bring this into the story?
I have a constant unease because, of course, I'm realizing that there's so many possibilities in so many areas I could be looking into. So one of them would be what you've just suggested, the kind of whole leftist discourse and how it's transformed since the 70s. But then there could be other areas. For instance, I have not been able to locate any important women in my study. Interesting people who are not men, who I would be able to, who would possibly give a different, perhaps, perspective. I'm talking now about the current situation. I'm also wondering if within the Kurdish community, more widely than Öcalan, there are so many other perspectives that I could be looking into. So it's really terrible how short time is. But thank you for the recommendation.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for a thought-provoking presentation. And earlier questions also discussed remarks were, to my opinion, more of related with inside the box or trying to open up more in-depth thing. My suggestion, if I may, or question also in that regard, is more towards perhaps broadening. In your research, my impression is that I didn't have chance to read it all, that you look more in-depth, which is necessary and useful. I have no problem with this. However, at the same time, perhaps we need to look, such as you look within the box, perhaps we need to look that box of Republic of Turkey, how that interacts with Europe. You mentioned briefly that similar process that Europe also have undergone in 18th and 19th centuries. Yes, but at that time, perhaps because of Ottoman decline, such interaction was much limited. But today, that interaction is higher. And what do you think about the European role in general, not as EU only, but more contemporary, which, to my impression, have not always been constructive or positive, to say the least. But I would like to hear more from you in that regard. And about that, perhaps, how do you interpret the role of EU in that ID construction? Because if you hear something from within the box, you need to think about with which forces this box is clashing or touching,
yes,
at least. For example, more specifically, because early on that the founders of modern Turkish Republic and later their continuing generations from the West, or by some circles in Europe being labeled as in quote fascists, and later in Europe that any terrorism or any act of aggression against Turks, it doesn't matter from whom it comes, Armenians or Kurds, being labeled as freedom fighters. To what extent do you think they contribute to those debates of nationalism? Evidently, those debates do not take place in isolation.
I mean, thank you for this. And however, I will not take your your suggestion, because of course we can discuss it. But the point is that. I cannot do a project about everything. If I had framed it as a project about politics, which is, by the way, my usual inclination to look at politics, so I'm trying to move away from politics and look a little bit at ideas without thinking where are they coming from, one, or also how are they influencing the political situation. So, because I cannot do everything, I want to sort of go in depth within that. Now, clearly, as you saw from my presentation, the context, the political context, the political relationship creeps in. It pops up constantly, and you have to have a sense of it. But I cannot actually make it the focus of my research, because then I would be doing a different project, which I have told the British Academy I will not do. Okay, but thank you. Yes.
You have a question?
Yeah, nobody else. Okay. So I would actually try to connect Peter's and Daniel's ideas about the story. I think there is a story, at least politically, in the Islamic discourse, and it is the oppressed. The oppressed has been a very dominant story that made the Islamic political discourse successful, I would say. And in this sense, it kind of connects with the whole idea of the left, radical leftist discourse of the past. So my question is this idea of the oppressed dominant in this literature? Because I think what it makes it successful,
yes,
it is this mazlum. So I was wondering whether this has a link with like the whole theoretical philosophical debate or their versions of universalism.
Shall I?
Of course.
I think it's undoubtedly there. And maybe it links with what Kara is saying about history to some extent.
Mm-hmm.
Because what Kara is saying, and by the way, that's a small part of what he's written about, as I said, I think, mm-hmm, is that there is that feeling of inferiority or of being sort of under threat, which actually creates all kinds of distortions in how, in self-perception, but also in the relationship with others. Now, clearly, when it comes to this country, the self-understanding as a victim has some element to it, because in this country's how shall I put it, authoritarian past, we do see all kinds of oppression, including of course, the Islamist discourses. This is how it was. And I think you're right to say that it has created a kind of I think Islamists are still grappling with that. I watched recently a film called I'm sure you all know it, Minni Ali Abdallah. Of course, my Turkish, I cannot understand anything. I can read a bit, but I cannot understand.
You can read the novel.
But yes, but also I could see the pictures. The film is very evocative, because of course it tells the story of an Islamist who is destroyed. He's imprisoned. He loses his family. You don't need to understand what they're saying. I was actually watching it to get the feel for it, and it really goes back to the heart of what you've just said, I think. Now, to what extent it's linked with, again, this is not my concern as much as looking at the ideas in isolation. And remember, my project is to link it to international relations and the calls for decentering IR, because that's where initially I am coming from. I'm coming from a very sort of English language dominated discipline, which is saying, okay, we are very English language dominated, we only see ourselves, there is a wider world out there. What about all these non-Western perspectives of these issues like culture and civilization? Surely they are there. And I think my project in some way is saying they are much more similar to us than you think. Now, of course, Turkey is one case, and it has very special relations, but everyone has special relations. And you can only do as much as you can do. But that's the origin of the project. The origin of the project is, okay, let's see what's happening a little bit outside our usual our usual zone. Because even if you read in international relations journals and books and stuff, often you read calls for looking at other perspectives outside the West, but you don't actually see reference to anything tangible. It's just calls for, but not actual research having been done. That's why I said in the beginning, I thought, okay, let me do some empirical research in order to report. It's a reporting project. Report, in some ways, not neutrally, because that never happens, but at least to say something about what's happening in a world which lies outside this. Now, that's not to say that there are not many, that, of course, Turkish academics do not also live in this world. Because, of course, Turkish academics in great numbers publish in the same journals, and they are part of that world. They're part of the conferences, and they live in the West, and they come and go, and we all know that. But not many of them necessarily actually read that stuff that I've just said. Even with my very intermediate Turkish, I'm still trying to read or to have a look into a literature or a discourse that is not usually looked at. So that's the point of the project. Sorry, I've gone on from your question.
So should I say a
few
words?
Yes, please, if you want to.
Okay. The story about victimhood. When I was doing nationalism studies many years ago, I remember in the literature there's always this reference to the Poles, who have internalized this victimhood, right, since the 18th century. It's actually, their image is of a nation which is nailed to the cross, sacrificed for the good of everything, everyone else, again and again. My Hungarian friends tell me they have a similar identity of being trampled upon by every passerby.
And so do the Greeks.
Okay.
We can tell you that.
Okay. Now, the Islamists have developed a sense of victimhood during the Republican period. That might be their story, but that's a story that they don't like at all. and they want to replace it as quickly as possible with a new story of success. And right now they are built, and I think they have actually built it. This is very actually similar to, there's an interesting parallel, I'm sure the Occupy people would not like to hear this, with the Jewish right in Israel, right, the settlers. For decades they heard the story of how socialist Zionists built the country. And then suddenly with the conquest of West Bank and Gaza, it was their turn. Now they had become the real Zionists. They began to claim the land, establish settlements of their own, and that was their contribution to the nation building story. So I see that kind of a parallel between the two cases.
The, also the Kemalists as well, I mean, in their early periods, are making the same claim vis-a-vis the Christian population of the Ottoman Empire, I suppose.
How so?
Well, in the sense that they're also presenting, on the both senses, like a kind of personal victimhood, you know, these kind of issues with their personal being slighted by non-Turkish Muslim groups and by the European presence, as well as this kind of writ large victimhood of, you know, Ottoman or Turkish anti-imperialism, or, in, you know, suffering at the hands of imperialism. And now we have this, the same kind of combination of a kind of international picture of, you know, being victim to this kind of one of personal slight, personal exclusion from the elite circles of Turkey.
There's one more question.
About the, you talked about the left wing, left liberals, let's say. I think the left liberals thought that at that time in the 1980s and 1990s, the Islamic movement would gradually evolve into democratic secularism. So rather than having a stringent secularism, a more soft democratic secularism, paving the road for different perspectives, as you say, in East and West, and creating and enriching the categories of thought. This was nurtured also by the international political developments, where people thought about an Arab Spring, where there will be more Islam, democratic, in peace with democracy and liberalism. But with today's development in Turkey, those left liberals also saw that this Islamic movement was used for a new totalitarian approach. And it didn't lead to more perspectives, but it led to more totalitarian approaches and even some kind of slowing down in implantation of democracy. What do you think this change will cause in the thoughts of people, the thinkers? Because now they saw the opposite, coming to a more totalitarian standpoint. Do you think there will be a reaction to turn into the older pattern with total westernization approaches, or a new approach of the whole, a new synthesis of all these forces? Because people came to an understanding that a moderate Islam does not work for many reasons, maybe. It's another area of research, probably. So what this will lead in the future, do you think, in the beliefs and attitudes of people in Turkey?
I mean, you say that moderate Islam doesn't work, but and I recognize that there's a considerable association at the moment in Turkey, as in many other parts of the world, between authoritarianism and Islamism. But we still have to recognize that the Islamists of the AKP are not the same mindset of people as they were 10 and 20 years ago. There was a shift to the political center. So even though it's difficult, I think, in the current situation in Turkey to see that, there has been progress along the years compared to what occurred before. I mean, I am optimistic about Turkey, and I think ultimately this difficult moment will be overcome, and there will be more progress. And one progress will be one element of that, in my view. I mean, that's a different discussion from what I've talked about. Is that there will be a recognition that the best way to protect religion is actually to de-link it from politics. And in that sense, I think, I think that is already happening in some of the people, some of the Islamist thinkers at least. They may be the minority, but they are there. That's my, really, I'm sorry, it's a bit jumbled, but that's my response to it.
So, I think we can continue with the discussion with a glass of wine. Let me thank the Turkish American Association once again for cooperating on this very vibrant presentation, discussion. And thank you very much to both our presenter and discussant.